over the world, Fleet Street means newspapers. And it's there that most of the journalists and the printing presses and the head offices of our national newspapers are found. But when you reach Temple Bar here, the City of London ends and the legal world takes over. And here the law courts, a vast, impressive Victorian fortress, looks down on the site which literally barred entrance to the City of London. Unhappily, the Temple Bar here, this old gateway, now moulders in a North London suburb. But if you came here at lunchtime, you would see a cascade of judges and barristers crossing over the road and disappearing down small alleyways and undistinguished corridors. And if you followed them, the chances are that you'd find yourself in the inner or middle temple. And once you're here, you leave behind the bustle and noise of Fleet Street. This is really an oasis in the heart of London, collectively known as the Temple. And the arches and the courts and the lanes and buildings of almost every architectural period make up these two inns of court. And it's here that the majority of barristers have their chambers and carry on their legal careers. For English law and English justice don't exist in a vacuum. And people, members of the public, come into the Temple every day for a whole host of reasons. It might be the representative of a great company wanting some technical commercial advice. It might be a man who's been injured at his place of work, lost three fingers in a machine, or perhaps suffered brain damage from some accident, seeking compensation from his employers. Or it might be a criminal case in which a man has been charged with drunken driving or indeed even murder. I used to come here before the war when my father had chambers in the Temple, and I must say the atmosphere hasn't changed at all. I suppose the main difference is that a lot of the buildings were destroyed by the bombing during the war, and therefore there's been a lot of rebuilding. One of the most interesting buildings, I think, is the library. That's got 150,000 books in it, not all legal, but mostly, and a lot of very interesting documents. I think one of the most macabre is Mary, Queen of Scots' death warrant, signed by her cousin, Queen Elizabeth I. And then a building I very much like is the Master's building, where he lives, the Master's house just next door to the Temple Church. That looks pure Wren, but in fact, of course, that has been built also since the war. And really, the Temple is an architectural student's paradise, because over the centuries, one's just gone on building and building, new buildings, more buildings for barristers' chambers. You've got, for example, the pure Jacobean of King's Bench Walk. You then have opposite it the Georgian period in paper buildings. And then across the way, the pure fruit salad of the Victorians. And then the bit of Neo-Georgian next door, where incidentally I started life as a pupil at the end there for my first year's pupillage. And so you've got this great jumble of buildings which somehow all seem to harmonize. Well, the architectural styles may change and modern buildings may be built, but many of the customs tend to survive. For example, the benchers, who are the senior members of the inn and really run the affairs of the inn, they're still summoned to dinner by the blowing of a horn. And I remember that before the war, certainly, they were trusted not to have to fill in bills, but merely tell the cashier what they'd had to eat. And I remember one bencher turning to my father and saying, it's not only the best and cheapest food in London, but it's the only place where you can get barley water free. And my father was horrified, and he said, no, he said, it's sixpence a glass. That was the end of the conversation, and the old gentleman was deep in thought for the rest of the meal, and then went up and was overheard say to the cashier, I've had liver and bacon, cheese and biscuits, and 496 glasses of barley water. Because the other custom which is continued here is the eating of dinners, that if you are a student, you have to eat a certain number of dinners every term. And this is one way in which people will get to know something about the inn which they're going to spend perhaps the rest of their lives. There were very few who were allowed not to eat dinners just after the war, largely because we'd been bombed out and there wasn't room. And I was one of those. And I remember just before I was called, the president of the Probate, Divorce and Admiralty Division, Lord Merriman, who was a formidable and rather terrifying man, came up to me and he said, before you're called, I must just formally ask you to confirm that you have eaten all your statutory dinners. And I said, no, I haven't eaten one, not one. I said, never eaten. It's the first time I've dined in this hall. there was an explosion and he retreated to tell the treasurer that I'd was trying to be called to the bar almost under false pretenses, and eventually he was placated and it was explained to him that I was a unique animal, at any rate in this regard, and I was duly called to the bar. Now, the lawyers were by no means the first people here. The Knights Templar were established in the temple in the 12th century. They were a religious order originally created to protect the holy places in Jerusalem, but the order spread to foreign countries, and they built this church, the Temple Church, in 1162, and it's a replica of their church in Jerusalem. They became more and more powerful. They were bankers to the king. They were the sort of Rothschilds of their day. They kept the crown jewels here. They were not simply a monastic order. They were a very powerful body who eventually fell out with the Pope. And as a result of that, the temple was transferred to another religious order, the Hospitallers, the Knights of St. John. And in the 14th century, they admitted the apprentices of the law as their tenants. And finally, in 1608, King James I granted the freehold of the temple to the societies of the Inner and Middle Temple, and they've been here ever since. The Temple Church has always been famous for its music, but it hasn't always been without controversy. In 1682, neither the Inner or Middle Temple could agree as to who should build the organ which they wanted to put into the church. There was a frightful row. The Inner Temple wanted Father Renatus Harris, the Middle Temple wanted Father Bernhard Schmidt. Because they couldn't make up their mind, they both commissioned organs to be made, and two organs were installed in the church, one to the right of the communion table, the other in the north side of the church. Well, this went on for some time, and there were raids made occasionally in the dead of night in order that one bit of organ could be taken out of one organ and put into the other. And finally, being good lawyers, they decided they would refer it to arbitration. And so the keeper of the Great Seal was impaneled, who promptly died, and so it was then referred to Judge Jeffreys of the famous Bloody Assize, who by then was Lord Chancellor, and he determined in favour of the Middle Temple organ, provided some of the best pipes were removed from the Inner Temple organ and put into the Middle Temple organ. Well, since then there have been no problems, and my link with the present organ, which was given to the temple from a country house after the war, was that when I was christened here, the organist was Dr. Thorben Ball, and he indeed is still the organist here in the Temple Church today.
Can I ask you about the Temple Choir, which of course is world famous? You train the choir,
yes,
as well as
yes,
play the organ. Yes. And how many choristers would there be?
Well, there were 16 boys, 8 aside, and 14 men. They became, I suppose, very well known through a record called Hear My Prayer, Over the Wings of a Dove, and so on, by Mendelssohn.
I was always brought up on the story of the master with the limp.
That was amusing. The procession consisted of the mace bearer, followed by the master, and then the choir. And the choir, of course, following the master. And when they were singing the hymn, He Who Would True Valor See Follow the Master, who had a limp, they followed him exactly.
What, limped into church?
Limped through the churchyard. Both the boys and the men, all limping. Of course, they behaved themselves the moment they arrived at the church door.
Can you tell us something about the restoration? I mean, is it the American bar that gave the...
The East End window,
yes.
And the windows are very fine. The restoration, the church looks much the same, apart from the pews. The pews are arranged differently. All the Purbeck columns are new. In fact, the mines at Purbeck were opened to obtain the marble for the new columns.
What, from which they'd originally been extracted?
Originally been extracted. Yeah. They're the same mines. And the church looks much the same, except, of course, before the war, it was very highly decorated. That's not quite the same now, but in its own way, I think it, in some ways, looks better than it did.
Was the new organ suitable for the church, or did you have to make a lot of adaptations?
Originally, it was much too loud. That's a curious story, in that it was in a house, a private, large house, certainly, in a ballroom. But the ballroom consisted of quite a number of antlers on the roof and thick carpets, settees and so on. And that evidently made the organ sounded rather on the quiet side. On the other hand, when it came here, it was the other way about. It was far too loud and had to be tamed considerably. But it now it's absolutely splendid. Couldn't be better.
The two inns each have a crest of their own, the lamb and flag of the Middle Temple, and the flying horse or Pegasus of the inner. Rivalry there's always been, but pretty cool stuff compared with that symbolized in the temple gardens.
Legend has it that the Wars of the Roses started here in the temple gardens, and Shakespeare relates in Henry VI how Somerset and Plantagenet, following a quarrel in the temple hall, went into the garden and plucked the red rose and the white rose, that the faction between the red rose and the white rose would send 1,000 souls to death and deadly night.
But that happened a long time ago, and today the gardens are peaceful. I asked a young barrister what he thought the future held for his profession.
That, to a very large extent, depends on the number of laws that Parliament, which means politicians, passes within the coming years. Personally, I would have thought that there would always be a very great demand, certainly for lawyers, and because of the advantages that there are to be had from a solicitor briefing a member of the bar in a particular case, I think that that must therefore apply to both professions.
Is there a shortage of people coming to the bar?
No, there's a very, very large number of people coming to the bar. In fact, I believe that in the last 15 years, the profession has increased by over 70%.
The image which a lot of people have of lawyers, I think, is of a man who is cross-examining in the courts and telling the witness that he's either mistaken in his memory or he wasn't there when he said he was, or in fact that he's telling lies. Do you feel that it's a fair comment that lawyers are not only a race apart, but are very often regarded as arrogant in their relationship with the lay public?
Firstly, he does cross-examine in court. Secondly, people do tell downright lies in court. And thirdly, it seems to me quite wrong that a profession which is perhaps renowned for wearing ties and detachable collars, not to mention waistcoats and gold chains, should be described as a race apart.
How do you see the future of the temple itself? Do you think it's going to change dramatically, or do you think that in your lifetime it'll carry on very much as before?
That, to a very large extent, is asking me whether or not I believe in legal tradition as applied in the temples. The answer is that I think it has very many advantages. And, of course, depending on which aspect of the tradition you're interested in, the one that strikes me as perhaps most relevant in my own particular situation is that when you actually join the bar, you find yourself eating dinners with people in exactly your position. Exact contemporaries, so it inevitably leads one to make friends within one's temple, which might not otherwise be the case in a parallel situation involving chartered surveyors or accountants. And that self-same process enables the bar to continue to be the closely knit profession that it is.
One unique factor about the temple is that it's a local authority in its own right. It's responsible for its own lighting and sewage and paving. It levies and assesses its own rates. And so when it negotiates with either the City of London or the GLC, it does so on equal terms. Well, the lawyers have been here for 600 years, and it's my bet that they'll be here for a very long time to come. And so long as governments and citizens operate under the rule of law, so long will we need lawyers to see that those laws are interpreted and implemented and carried out. And to put it perhaps in a rather more cynical way, I remember the story of the crime reporter who said to the editor,
Chief, he said, we haven't had any serious crimes committed for the last fortnight, but I refuse to lose my faith in human nature.